Welcome to Bike Week Radio Show.
Powered by GEICO. 15 minutes can save you 15% or more on motorcycle insurance.
Bike Week Radio Show with six-time AMA champion and motorcycle Hall of Famer, Broc Glover, Bobby Wooldridge, Paul Carruthers, and Scott Cox. It's Bike Week Radio Show on San Diego's sports leader, the mighty 1090.
Good morning and welcome into Bike Week Radio Show on San Diego sports leader, the mighty 1090. Thank you guys again for making us part of your Sunday morning routine. Good to have three out of the four in studio this morning. And if you ask me by the power rankings, the top three. Broc Glover here. Good to have you, buddy.
Ooh, I bet Paul has something to say about
that. Don't worry, he's not on the phone line yet.
Okay, yes.
He's seething.
Okay. He's probably listening on the app, though.
Ooh, that is true. If you don't have the Bike Week Radio Show smartphone app, what the heck are you waiting for? It's free. Just head to the app store. It's good for iPhone, good for Android, good for Google Play or whatever smartphone you have. It's on the app store because that's what we do for you guys. And check that out and download it. Scott Cox, also in studio. Good to have you, buddy.
Good to be here, Bobby. This is going to be a great show. Always looking forward to hanging out with you guys, of course, but the fact that we get to do a show together makes it even better.
He would prefer to be called Captain Bobby.
Captain. Captain
Bobby.
Yeah,
that is
true.
There's
no T in there. It's just Captain.
You are a sailboat owner.
I might have to sneak into the show that comes on before us, Let's Talk Hookup, because I am the proud new owner of a 13-foot sailboat.
That we christened the Raging Queen.
Actually,
in honor of the Pride weekend.
Head to BikeWeekRadioShow.com. I am accepting boat names. I have to name it before tomorrow morning.
Awesome boat. It's a laser. I mean, that is, if you've ever sailed on a little, what is it, 13-footer?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's the one to have, Bobby.
Well, right now, the leader.
You got the Broc Glover of 13-foot.
Well, that's the leader in the clubhouse right now for the name on the boat is the Golden Boy, and I'm going to have Broc come down and autograph the side of it.
That's pretty good.
Sweater vest,
little
Sperry topsiders with the Golden Boy cruising around.
Absolutely.
You'll never sail alone.
I'm gonna wearing my polo shirt and the collar is flipping up as we speak.
I'm popping double collars for that day.
Well, also joining us via the hotline up at Laguna Seca, who's gonna give us a few minutes. I appreciate it. He's got a busy day today. But Paul Carruthers, good morning, buddy.
Good morning to you guys. It's 13 feet. That's like a surfboard.
That's a little smaller than some surfboards, Paul.
I got a good name for you, though.
What do you got?
The Wee Woo.
Oh, oh yeah.
Well, see,
I'm here all day.
Don't forget to tip your waiters.
Paul, I'm undercompensating is what they call it.
I get it.
Well, let's just hop into the news here with Paul Carruthers.
Nobody knows the news better than Bike Week Radio Show.
This was an age when only men were allowed to read the news.
And only Bike Week Radio Show has Paul Carruthers.
Hey, I'm here. We can do the news now. It's all right, everyone. We can do the news. Hold on. Everyone, why are we all standing around? Let's go.
Take it away, buddy.
Well, guess what? I'm in beautiful Monterey, California. And like anywhere that Moto America travels this year, it's officially raining. I guess we're getting. I talked to home yesterday, and it sounds like we're getting the weather that you guys had yesterday, which is a bit strange. It's there's a bit of lightning and thunder, and it looks like it's going to clear up, but who knows? But anyways, we had some wet practice sessions this morning, and then the first Moto America race goes off at about 9:30. It's obviously a pretty hectic schedule with sharing the weekend with World Superbikes. So, I mean, at least we're at a racetrack where racing in the rain is not an issue. It's a fully homologated track for both World Superbike and MotoGP, which means that they can race in the rain. So I think we'll have a good day right now. I mean, there's a little bit of sunshine, and who knows? Maybe we'll just get lucky, and it'll be nice because it sure has been nice for the rest of the week that we've been here. Believe it or not, Chaz Davies earned pole position yesterday for today's two World Superbike race. Not that Chaz is slow or anything, but it's hard to believe that it's actually his first career World Superbike pole because he's one of the top guys in the series on the factory Ducati, and I was somewhat shocked when somebody told me that that's actually his first pole position. So the other thing that's a little bit strange is there's no Kawasaki's on the front row of a World Superbike race. I don't think that's happened in at least a couple of years with the way that Tom Sykes has been dominating. And now he's got Jonathan Ray on his team, who's winning the championship by a zillion points and has basically been winning all the races. The ones that he hasn't won have been won by Sykes. So Kawasaki's been dominant, and so it's a bit unusual that they're not on the front row, but qualifying's qualifying and racing's racing. So I don't think there's too many people that would bet against those guys being at the front today for those races. So we'll just have to see how that goes. David Giugliani is second.
Paul should open his own language school.
Yeah, he's Chaz Davies' teammate on the factory Ducati, and so he's second. And third is World Superbike rookie Jordi Torres, and he's on the factory Aprilia. It's pretty impressive that it's not only his rookie season of World Superbike racing, but it's his first time he's been to Laguna Seca, and this place is a bit notorious for taking a while to get sorted out. So it's impressive that he's able to come here and after just a couple of days put that thing on the front row. So we're looking forward to those two races today. Moto America, we had two races yesterday, and we crowned our first series champion. Joe Roberts won the Superstock 600 race, and with that wrapped up the title. His rival in the series was Richie Escalante, and he crashed out of the lead on the fifth lap and didn't score any points. So that pretty much meant that Roberts just had to cruise around. He didn't necessarily cruise around. He was in a good battle and barely won the race, but with that took the title. So he's the first ever Moto America Series champion. The Superstock class races two more times in New Jersey. They don't race at Indy, so there's only 50 points available, and he's got a 60-some point lead, so the title is his. We had a KTM RC 390 Cup race yesterday that was won by Canadian Brandon Ort. He's 15 years old, really fast, really nice kid. It was his second win in a row. Now, that was the series we actually thought was going to be wrapped up yesterday because Cage McAllister, who's a supermoto kid from Northern California. I think he's won four races so far this year, and he had a really big points lead. And basically, we figured that title was going to get wrapped up yesterday by him, but his KTM threw a chain early in the race, and he didn't finish. So now we go to New Jersey with that championship still available. Cage has a good lead in the championship, but at least they've still got some hope. Those other guys and Braden Ort's riding really well, and like I said, won two races in a row, and who knows what can happen. Racing's racing, and we didn't think that Cage McAllister was going to have the problems he had. So you never know what's going to happen. In Superbike, our buddy Josh Hayes earned his fourth pole position of the season. He was helped a little bit by Cameron Bobier. Had a pretty big crash right away. They do a 15-minute super pole session, and
but he didn't help Cameron have that crash, did he?
No.
Okay.
So Cameron crashed. I think from maybe his third lap, he had the fastest time at that point, and he walked away okay. But the bike was a little slightly used, and he had to run back to the paddock and get on a second bike. He was able to do a fast enough lap to finish second ahead of Roger Hayden, but not fast enough to beat his teammate, Josh. So those guys will line up. That's your front row, Josh Hayes, Cameron Bovier on the two factory Yamahas, and then Roger Hayden on the Yoshimura Suzuki. So I think we're going to have two good races there. We've also got Super Sport today, and that's actually it. The KTM guys and Superstock 600 only race one here because we're obviously sharing the weekend with World Superbike, so there wasn't enough space in the schedule to get those guys two races. But there'll be two Superbike races today, actually four Superbike races, two World Superbike and two Moto America. So we look like we've got a big crowd here. There was a lot of people here yesterday, and there should be more today. And I don't know where else you can go and watch four quality Superbike races on one day. So I think the fans are going to have a nice afternoon, and hopefully they can stay dry. There's a lot of people out here camping, so I'm sure their night was a little interesting with the lightning and pretty heavy rain. So that's about it from my end.
Paul, a couple of points. I wanted to give you a shout-out and give you congratulations. Nice story set up in the Monterey Herald with Wayne Rainey.
Oh, thanks.
Yeah.
Yeah, that worked out. That worked out really well. And, yeah, I mean, it makes perfect sense. I mean, he's obviously local guy, and he's done a lot. Yeah, it was good. Those guys did a nice job of putting that together. I was impressed. I thought they'd be on the front page maybe of the sports section. It was on the front page of the entire newspaper. So
maybe you can bring us some autographed copies or something, just saying.
Yeah, I know him pretty well. I think I can, if I put a pen in his hand, he might do that.
That'd be cool. And also, interesting news, Broc will weigh in on this. Our former guest and, you know, a front-running competitor in your series, Jake Gagne, is going to race Utah Motocross. He's going to race the National at Miller Motorsports Park, which is pretty cool.
Yeah, we actually got in a little trouble this morning for letting that story out because their press release wasn't done or whatever. But
I kept it under the hat because I've known
they
about it.
They should have kept
it
going.
Part of the problem. Yeah.
Now we're part, yeah.
You know what? When you listen to Bike Week Radio Show, you know we break the news before it's set up to be broken.
I mean, it's hard for somebody like me and, you know, to hold back on news, considering that's what I've been doing for 30 years. But it wasn't actually me. Matt Miles talked to Gagne yesterday, and Gagne told him everything, and we ran with it. And then today we're in a little hot water, but shit, I can get us out of that. Uh-oh, did I say something bad?
Yep, I got it.
What, hot water? Agua caliente?
Paul Carruthers.
Slipped the cock
The up. Bad boy of radio. He's back.
That way we know it's him.
We just took the title from him.
Yeah, you know, if it was an imposter, he wouldn't speak like that.
Anybody could call in.
I think that's really cool news. I mean, apparently Jake's really good on a motocross bike, and it sounds like he's gotten a lot of help from Yamaha, and he's, you know, they're going to have their semi there, and
I think it's awesome.
He's got factory.
I might even fly there to see that.
Yeah, I mean, I'm thinking about doing the same. It's the weekend after we're in Indianapolis. So, I mean, it's only like 3 weeks.
Shoot,
we could swing out there on
You're
Saturday
doing better now. You're doing better
we're
now.
In, Paul.
You threw in a shoot. I like that. Yeah, no, Bobby's over
he's
there.
He's learning, yeah.
Bobby's got his twitchy finger going.
Bobby's hand going for the
button? He's total twitchy finger over here. I don't know what he's got going.
What honestly we need is like
actually
5 seconds of silence to build up our
Bobby's
our
been
again.
Thumbing through the latest issue of Nautical Mail.
Right. I'll have to watch myself. Bobby probably gets scared when I say fun.
No. Easy, man. You had me going again.
I know. All right.
Well,
guys, I'll let you go. But yeah, the Gagne thing's cool. It's I don't think he's going to embarrass us by any means. I think there's a lot of people that say that he could be a top 15 guy, so we'll see where that goes.
You know, it's August 15th, the day after Scott's birthday.
That's right.
So it's
that'd be a cool birthday trip to SLC.
Just jump on.
It would be
a
cool birthday if Broc flew you and I out there. That you'd enjoy that for your birthday,
it's
right?
Done.
I think so.
Yeah.
Get that private plane. Well, Bobby can come too because you know my jet.
Bobby's going to be out on the bay.
Yeah, I have a big jet.
Can Bobby sail there?
He's going to tighten his jib.
Landlocked.
Phil Cotner and I met this week, producer of Bike Week Radio Show, and we did give you a homework assignment. Just a reminder, we're trying to target Josh Hayes to come on in August, so you do have some homework to do up there for us. Go ahead and track him down, see if you can line him up for maybe August.
Yes, please.
Yeah, we can make that happen, and we'll even bring Melissa in because she's better to look at.
Actually, that was kind of the lure. We figured if Josh came, it'd be easier to get her in studio.
Yeah, I mean, right. We invite Josh just so we can get Melissa to come.
Well, exactly. She'd probably beat him to the studio anyway. So,
yeah, she's been a little under the weather, but she's racing today in Super Sport, and her and two or three other girls won a big endurance race in, I don't know if it was Europe or Japan, but she was
Japan. I saw
that
on her Facebook page.
Yeah, it was like a Suzuka 4-hour or something. So, she's pretty pumped to have won that. But also, I think just the lot of traveling she's been doing lately, she's a bit under the weather. But she's a tough kid, and I'm sure she'll suck it up and be just fine. But, yeah, I'll get them both in the studio, and we'll have some fun.
Awesome, buddy. Well, we always appreciate you checking in from the road. And,
right, and you play like Christopher Cross music now during the break, or what?
Yeah. Well, we actually have some Lyle Lovett music coming up.
Yeah, and he's
shortly.
Got some nautical tunes.
Lyle Lovett is expected to join the program.
And I'm actually going to make down.
What was that?
I'm going to go see him Monday night.
That's right.
We can sit with Bobby in his little scow.
Yeah, and in my new boat, I can sail over right to Humphreys by the Bay as Lyle is coming to town Monday, which is tomorrow, July 20th. And we're currently targeting Lyle right now as the tour bus is making its way down the coast.
So if it's 13 feet long, is that like you, one other person, and a six-pack, and it's pretty full, right?
Hey, you, me, and a bottle of wine, Paul.
Oh, great. All right, well, I look forward to sailing in the wee-woo boat.
You got it, buddy.
Wee-woo.
Bye, talk to you.
Ahoy.
We have Broc Glover in studio. Broc was lucky enough to stick at home for a weekend, and it's bike week for the better because we get to have you in studio on a Sunday morning, that means.
You know, it really was nice to be home other than that crazy weather we had. Mm-hmm. Like, wake up this morning, go into the office just to check a few things, and there's about five ants crawling on my desk, and I'm
we had that visitation, too.
Oh, you little SOB. Oh, boy. Well, you know, we flood them out, and we flood them out in the yard, and they figure out a way to sneak in your house, and it's frustrating, but welcome to California. But, yeah, it was really, really nice, and, you know, I honestly, I got to give it up to my little girl, my daughter, JC. She worked so hard. There's actually one professional choir group in San Diego, and they're called Sacra Profana. And every summer they put on this little camp, and they take in students that would like to perform. And they did an unbelievable performance last night at the Spreckles Theater. And remember, we had the Marty Motes movie debut down there
That's
in San Diego.
Spot.
What a great
that
old
is
theater.
A great venue.
Downtown. And they were incredible. There was 95 students signed up for this. And there's 20, I think 25-ish professional singers. And they teach them all week long. And they put on, this is the second year in a row they did it. And it was, I was amazed, honestly, how good they were, and it was just a fantastic evening, so I'm glad I did not miss that. Last year, I flew home, left early from Millville, ditched the second motos, jumped on a plane, flew home with zero delays. Everything worked perfectly, and I walked in about a half a song late. Hmm. So I'm like, you know, this year, I can't miss these opportunities.
You're smarter this year.
And I stayed home, and it was well worth it. Had a wonderful evening with the family, so... But I did catch up on the Millville motocross, you know, through some phone calls. Obviously, watching the results, watched some of it live on the internet while it rained outside, and caught some extra bit on the TV and this morning. So I think most people, if they did catch it on the TV, probably a little bit of the only surprise would say that two of the Minnesota natives, Ryan Dungey and Jeremy Martin, did not win overall. Ryan Dungey did with a perfect 1-1, including fastest qualifying in the 450 class. Kind of broke that mini streak that Justin Barcia, you know, Justin Barcia kept going 2-1, 2-1, and got the overall each time, even though he wasn't gaining any points on Ryan Dungey. Dungey was able to bounce back and go 1-1 at his home track. And then Jeremy Martin, whose family owns the track, and basically he's, you know, born and raised about a block down the road from the actual entrance to the racetrack, and, you know, the son of John and Greta Martin, who John Martin actually raced factory KTM, or Can-Am,
Hair Scrambles champion.
And a Hair Scrambles champion. He's a very accomplished rider.
They interviewed him. It was great. They said, hey, so what do you think about your sons? This is great. He goes, yeah, they're okay.
Yeah.
That was his quote.
Understated, to say the least. But, yeah, Jeremy Martin had fastest qualifying time. The track was quite muddy in the morning. I was trying to get a little bit more of a weather report, but I'm sure they were bolting on MX-11 paddle tires and everything else to get some traction there. And then, as you saw in the race, even Marvin Musquin hit a berm too hard and the front end buried in the hole.
In fact, those Martin boys before Moto One gave a shout-out to Dunlop to that time.
Yeah, they run and they do. Especially, you know, it's funny because Alex runs that MX-11, as does the other guy that runs it a lot is Zach Osborne. He ran it both motos at Red Bud.
Really?
Yeah, he practiced on it a lot, and they really like it. And so... they run the paddle-style tire almost all the time. So, but Jeremy Martin, for sure, you know, he came back with a nice convincing win in the second moto over Cooper Webb. But that's Cooper Webb's first overall and of the year, and then it was fantastic to see him bounce back from a long season of, you know, injuries and things, and he really didn't re-enter the series until Bud's Creek after going down in the second moto at Hangtown. So he's you know, he's definitely a force to be reckoned with, and the speed wise. But Cooper Webb was the overall winner with a 1-2. Jeremy Martin went 3-1, and Joey Savacci was nice to see.
Looked pretty good.
Yeah, you know, it was nice to see the pro circuit guys get back on the podium. It wasn't that long ago that team was
struggled.
If you weren't on that team, you were nobody. I mean, do you remember what two or three years
total
ago?
Total domination.
You know, here they were first, second, third, fourth at the Las Vegas Supercross, and they just, you know, they at the shootout, you know, it was the Josh Hansons of Tickles and the guys like that were all on the team and dominating, and they've definitely had some tough breaks. You know, Adam Cincerello has been injured a lot. He was kind of their next Ryan Villopoto, to put it in certain ways, and so it's been a tough race at the Lucas Oil AMA Pro Motocross Championships for the Pro Circuit team, but they're bouncing back. And the only thing I really noticed, it didn't look like there was much of a crowd. I don't know if the weather has bounced it, you know, keeping it harder to do it, or you know, people coming out, the fans. To me personally, I think part of the problem is you've got live TV or most of the races, and then you have $40 ticket prices and another $10 or $20 to get in the pits. And if you want to stay in the pits all day long so you can kind of see all the action, you got to pay $50 to get that ticket pit pass. Mm-hmm. Start adding it up, and then you start throwing wait a minute, we want to come in on Friday and camp, you know,
hotel,
and then it's $60-$70 a person, I guess it is, and I think it's 70 or 80. It's quite expensive. And then you start saying, I got, you know, two kids and a wife, and next thing you know, it's like, really, seriously? I can just stay home and watch this live on TV.
So, or two wives and a kid.
Yeah, exactly. You know,
that's next month when we go to Salt Lake.
You need
Lake.
To get a longer boat. So it's just one of those things where, I mean, looking at it, it's the you don't know what causes the downward spiral, but it's, you know, when you charge that much to come to a race that you can watch on TV, it is start to become a problem. And I know you can see more live when you're walking around, seeing all the little mm-hmm. details, but the overall race you can actually see better on TV. It's kind of like a football game, so where you get the replays and the whole deal.
Plus, you have all your conveniences right there.
Exactly. So I don't know. It's they're going, well, we're losing money, so what do? Raise the prices of the ticket?
You can't
do that. You're going to make it worse. And it's kind of like raising, we need government, we need more money, so we raise taxes. Well, it just kills the economy. So it's, they've got some soul searching to do, I think. Yeah. And I know I've heard some rumbling that they've actually lost money this year so far promoting the races, and it's a serious problem.
And
for
it's
them.
A big undertaking. I mean, you put it on is. Even a small race where you've got to have all your staffing and you've got mm-hmm. the facility handled and traffic flow and all those things. So even when everything's perfectly established, it's a lot of work, and you're going to fight for every penny. So when you don't have your attendance numbers up, that makes it doubly painful.
Well, no question about it. And the cost, even though you'd think, oh, wait a minute, you know, putting on a TV package, that, you know, don't they get paid to have something on TV? And it's quite the opposite. To put motocross on is a very expensive proposition for producing a show. It takes a lot of people. It takes a lot of equipment. You know, it's a traveling circus from race to race with all those semis full of TV stuff. You've got a lot of staff putting it on, and they do a great job putting on a TV production. So that's just more the reason why you just stay at home and watch it.
No, they do, and they, you know, our friend Dan Walsh, who's been in studio with us here, and we've known for many, many years. I mean, he's part of the Lucas Oil production team. I mean, they're there with all the A students, all the equipment, and, you know, they're all in terms of the television production. Mm-hmm. So it offers a wonderful experience for people that don't have the ability to actually be at the race.
Yeah, it does. So, you know, again, that's kind of the problem. I just, like I said, noticed the crowds were down a little bit. And I think, you know, Redbud had a good crowd, but it's not the crowd they had 3 years ago or
no,
4 years
not,
ago. When
not
they had
by 30, any stretch.
You know, 30, 40,000, 35,000 people where you could barely move. So, you know, the weather and combination of the prices and things, it's definitely got some evaluating to do during this offseason, no question about it. But the series itself is great. You know, the racing's tight. 250 class is the usual crap shoot where guys are finishing, you know, like, you know, Jordan Smith, for instance, a 12.5 or, you know, a Shane McElrath, 11.6.
I mean, or even Alex.
Yeah, Alex Martin. Well, yeah, he ended up getting, well, if you saw that, Alex Martin ended up going 4:14, but you also saw him tangle early with Marvin Musquin, where Marvin got sideways, Alex yep. clipped him, and Alex went down. So I think the Martin family, no question about it, was hoping for two of the kids on the podium, and I'm sure they were capable of putting two kids on the podium or two rider, you know, family members on the podium at their home track, but just didn't work out the way everybody expected it. But that's racing, right?
Is it also like a little bit of the down attendance, sort of like a similar parallel to golf? Because I've heard you compare James Stewart and Tiger Woods' career arc is, you know, both sports are losing their superstar and still looking for, you know, the next superstar, which is only a once-in-a-generation type of guy sometimes. And so,
yeah, sometimes it is, including the personality and whatever
exactly.
whatever reason. You know, I remember when James came out, and it was so much fun, you know, seeing him do dances and things on the
yeah.
stage, and he looked like he was having so much fun in the crowd.
And he was a lot of fun to watch just riding.
Yeah, right, I mean, he was, exactly. Rider. And you've got Tomac injured, and you've got other top stars. You know, Eli Tomac's been hurt. And so, you know, that does make a difference, no question about it. You know, but I mean, it was also a little mention that it was nice to see Josh Grant back on the racetrack. I mean, Factory Kawasaki, since their riders have been injured and didn't have any riders on the track,
worked out nicely for him.
They offered Josh Grant an opportunity to come back and race their factory bike out of their factory rig. So worked out well. I think he qualified about fourth or fifth or something. Did real well in qualifying and ended up, you know, a solid top 10 overall. He went 10-9, but I'm sure it's going to take a little bit to ride himself back into that pace and the shape that the guys up front are going. And so that's kind of the report from there.
Good stuff. And next week up to Washougal for you guys.
It is a quick trip up the coast of beautiful Portland and drive across that Columbia River to the iconic Washougal racetrack.
Mm-hmm. What a place.
It is. It's really, I think it's probably the favorite track for people to go to.
Yeah. I mean, as a spectator, I mean, there's nothing like Washougal. And plus, you know, like you're saying, Brock, if you fly in, you're going to stay in Portland, and just the drive in there in the morning, you're going, coming from here in Southern California, you go, there's no way you could actually even envision having a motocross track amongst all these trees. And
right. You just go across the river, across the Columbia River. So you got to visualize this on the radio. And then you just head a little bit east, following the river down. Mm-hmm. And you're like, oh, this is beautiful pine trees everywhere. You just turn up this small road and you follow the Washougal River right up this beautiful canyon, windy road. There's places people are pulling off after the races and jumping off into the river, and it's just really neat.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden you're there. You just turn left, and wow, here's the racetrack.
And even just driving there, if you don't go to the track, we did a KTM road bike intro there many years ago, and it's spectacular if you don't even go to the track. And then you go to the track and ride it or watch a national Brock's going to be at next week. It's dreamland.
It is. It's really, really nice. It's easy to get in and out of most of the time. There's a little bit of traffic coming out there sometimes, but they've done a better job of rerouting it, and it's just a nice facility. It's, again, the pine trees and the location, and I think, you know, favorite track is probably Redbud for the riders, but, you know, Washougal is a nice venue for the
spectators. Then you can go to Salty's afterwards for dinner.
That's right. Exactly. So,
well, good stuff. Nice long, fat news segment for you guys out there. You're welcome. You can send donations to BikeWeekRadioShow.com at any time. Care of Bobby Wooldridge. You know, make sure you mark that. Otherwise, I'll have to split it with these guys. But coming up
there, that kid.
He's already got.
I
got
to pay for the sailboat somehow.
He's got money problems because he owns a boat. What is it? The best days of a boat owner: the first day when you buy it, and the last day when you first.
Yeah, but I'll tell you, he bought right.
Yeah, he did.
He practically was paid to take that boat.
I know.
Well, when we come back, we are still looking for the one and only Lyle Lovett, who will be playing Humphreys by the Bay tomorrow. And also, we have a lot of listeners here in Southern California area. He's at the Fox Performing Arts Center in Riverside tonight. And so,
tonight.
Beautiful theater. So if you're in Riverside area or in the adjacent surrounding places, go check him out. Lyle Lovett tonight.
You know, poor Lyle, this is one that he's going to take in the shorts, because how many of our motorcycle friends live in and around? Start with Malcolm Smith and just go down the list. How many guys... I mean, most of the house, it might as well just be a house party, because...
Yeah, he's in the IE, the Inland Empire, and there's a few people. Yeah, he's a few miles down the road from the Glen Helen Racetrack and all. And Milestone, just north of Temecula. I'm sure there's a lot of people calling
Lyle's such a nice guy. He's not going to make a penny on that show, because he's going to be giving out free tickets to all his friends in that area.
He's always smiling, though.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, I'm sure... I'm sure Lyle's going to be in the red after this show.
Yeah, I'll have to learn. I'm sure he's learning how to say no, but
we're
looking forward to.
Well, no. I hope he learns to say no after Tuesday.
If you if you haven't seen Lyle and his large band ever perform, it's people go there that's never, I don't even know his music. And then they all of a sudden they come away and huge fans.
What a show.
Exactly. It's a guy's even like, how about Wallenberg? He was dumbfounded afterwards. Mm-hmm.
Dumbstruck.
He's the biggest fan. Scott Wallenberg's now the biggest fan. And because he'd never seen him live. And then he sees him live and it's like, this is completely.
Well, a dozen world-class musicians all on one stage. I mean, it's impressive.
It is very, very impressive. And it's quite a show. So get down to Humphrey. Or if you're tonight, rip over to the Fox.
What is it? The Fox
Performing Arts Center, Riverside.
Riverside.
Yeah, downtown. It's on Mission, isn't it?
Yep,
right down old Riverside. So,
well, as we head to break, let's help you with one of those helpful riding hints from our good friends at Russ Brown Motorcycle Attorneys.
Russ Brown Motorcycle Attorneys have been representing riders for decades. And here's Chuck Coro from Russ Brown Motorcycle Attorneys to provide you with a helpful riding hint.
People often get frustrated at the time it takes to resolve their personal injury case, but to maximize the recovery, medical treatment has to be completed and the records and bills obtained. Also, loss of earnings documents are needed. This takes time. There are a host of other reasons why cases do not settle quickly. Oftentimes, the insurance company disputes the fault issue, witnesses may not be cooperating, sometimes the police report isn't made available for months, and the list goes on. Rarely does the case settle within a few months after the accident.
This helpful hint has been brought to you by Russ Brown Motorcycle Attorneys at 1-800-4-BIKERS or online at russbrown.com.
Here's an idea. Bear with me. You could save quite a bit of money just by switching your motorcycle insurance to Geico. Piles of it, in fact. But there may not be a lot of room on your bike for all that extra cash. So I had somewhat of an idea. You could get one of those nifty little sidecars, pile it up with all that money you just saved, and merrily drive on your way. It's just a thought. Just off the top of my head.
Call Geico today for a free motorcycle rate quote. Geico, saving people money on more than just car insurance.
Summer, the sun burns brighter and the double yellows are your guide. On a Harley-Davidson motorcycle, it's never about where you're going, just how far. El Cajon Harley-Davidson has custom-designed riding gear built for your body, the bike, and every shift of summer. Around the corner or all the way to the 75th Sturgis Motorcycle Rally. Stop into El Cajon Harley-Davidson and check out the great deals on used bikes and financing offers. Visit ElCajonHarley.com for more details. Russ Brown Motorcycle Attorneys are the real deal. Russ Brown Motorcycle Attorneys. Their entire practice is dedicated to representing motorcyclists. As riders themselves, they understand why you ride, the issues you face, and the motorcycle culture. For over 30 years, Russ Brown and his partner Chuck Coro have been helping injured motorcyclists and their families get the care and compensation they deserve. Russ Brown Motorcycle Attorneys also created BAM.
BAM!
A nationwide buddy system of over 2 million riders helping riders in the event of a roadside emergency. BAM offers free legal advice, and thanks to Russ Brown, they have staff on hand to take your call 24/7, 365 days a year.
Imagine a real person answering the phone 24/7.
Just call 1-800-4-BIKERS for more information and to get your BAM card today. If you go down,
call Russ Brown.
1-800-4-BIKERS and online at russbrown.com.
Welcome back, Bike Week Radio Show, San Diego sports leader, the Mighty 1090. Thank you guys again for checking out the program. If you missed any of today's show or any of our previous shows, at bikeweekradioshow.com, or you can check out the podcast via the Bike Week Radio Show smartphone app. Fellas, I know we're not...
Christopher Cross, that's the bomb.
Sailing...
Well, that's also another potential boat name. If you have boat names, you can submit it at bikeweekradioshow.com. I do need a boat name still. Sticks and Stones, spelled STYX, like sticks and rolling stones, and play some rock music.
Yeah, that's not going to work.
play Come Sail Away the entire time. Butte, Montana. How cool is this event? July 23rd to the 25th is Evel Knievel Days.
Imagine what happens there. Days. Imagine the calamity that.
This is sort of the appetizer for that area as they get ready for Sturgis, the 75th annual Sturgis Rally, which is in the first week of August.
Just think about it. You could cruise up California, head north, head over to Montana, and then cruise
I've
all
done
over
that.
To
I've
Sturgis.
Done that cruise before.
There's some pretty stuff up there, Yellowstone and all that. But can you imagine the Evel Knievel Days? There's a lot of memorabilia there, huh?
Yeah, and then they got shows coming on for Evel Knievel. They got they got all kinds of like tributes, and there's guys jumping stuff, and they got the wheel of death or the ball of death or whatever, where it's the guy inside the cage, and he's just spinning loops inside the cage. I never get tired of seeing that.
And I wonder how many guys will attempt a new world's record during Evel Knievel Days. You know, officially authorized by the event, and those that are just going to bootleg it.
Yeah, absolutely. And again, Sturgis coming to that area. They're going to South Dakota. It is 14 days away. I'm at Sturgis 75th
anniversary.
I'm watching the counter right now. Countdown to the rally: 14 days, 14 hours, 20 minutes, and 45 seconds. That's right now. Coming to Sturgis, and next weekend we'll have Rod Woody Woodruff on from the Buffalo Chip. What an interesting character he is. We had him on last year, and definitely a good time.
You know, speaking of Sturgis, our friends at Elko and Harley Davidson, they have some cool little seminars and workshops for their customers and those that just want to sign up and participate. And among the things that they were promoting recently was a long haul workshop. And it's for guys. I mean, there are a lot of people that we know over the years that ride from here all the way to Sturgis, which is quite an undertaking. But not everybody, just because you ride doesn't mean you really understand what it takes to go thousands of miles on a motorcycle, you know, by yourself or with a pack. So a tip of the Bike Week Radio Show visor to those guys out at Elko and Harley Davidson for understanding that and offering their expertise to Sturgis ride hopefuls.
Yeah, and we'll also be checking in with Russ Brown Motorcycle Attorneys, as they always have a huge presence up at the Sturgis Rally. And I'm just checking out some of the concerts. The concerts they have at the Buffalo Chip are epic. And for the 75th anniversary Sturgis Rally, ZZ Top, I saw Alice Cooper coming to town up there. 38 Special. I think they're the Hold On Loosely. I think that's their one of their
Look
songs.
Look at you, Bobby.
Leonard Skinner, John Fogerty.
I wonder if that was on the
Def Leppard Sticks
dashboard radio when you were just a twinkle in Papa Wu's eye.
Yeah, they don't mess around up there for the Sturgis Rally. I think the 75th annual might be a little ambitious for me to go to because it's too hectic. I that one's going to be wild, but maybe 70.
Plus, Bobby will be sailing.
Yeah, that's true. But good stuff. And as we track down Mr. Lyle Lovett, let's pop out for one more break here, Adam Clark. But when we come back, hopefully we'll be joined by the man, the myth, the legend.
He might be riding. He's got that trick
true.
New 125, actually 74, 125 WR model Husky that was pretty sweet when I saw it. And I know he spun some loops recently up in Boise. Anxious to talk to him about that.
And maybe you can convince him to hop on one of those new Indian motorcycles you're telling me about in the back.
If he hasn't already.
Mm. Well, more Bike Week Radio Show coming up next, right here on San Diego Sports Leader, the Mighty 1090.
Russ Brown Motorcycle Attorneys are the real deal. Russ Brown Motorcycle Attorneys. Their entire practice is dedicated to representing motorcyclists. As riders themselves, they understand why you ride, the issues you face, and the motorcycle culture. For over 30 years, Russ Brown and his partner Chuck Coro have been helping injured motorcyclists and their families get the care and compensation they deserve. Russ Brown Motorcycle Attorneys also created BAM.
BAM.
a nationwide buddy system of over 2 million riders helping riders in the event of a roadside emergency. BAM offers free legal advice, and thanks to Russ Brown, they have staff on hand to take your call 24/7, 365 days a year.
Imagine a real person answering the phone 24/7.
Just call 1-800-4-BIKERS for more information and to get your BAM card today. If you go down,
call Russ Brown,
1-800-4-BIKERS, and online at russbrown.com.
Here's an idea. Bear with me. You could save quite a bit of money just by switching your motorcycle insurance to Geico. Piles of it, in fact. But there may not be a lot of room on your bike for all that extra cash. So I had somewhat of an idea. You could get one of those nifty little sidecars, pile it up with all that money you just saved, and merrily drive on your way. It's just a thought. Just off the top of my head.
Call Geico today for a free motorcycle rate quote. Geico, saving people money on more than just car insurance.
Summer, the sun burns brighter, and the double yellows are your guide. On a Harley-Davidson motorcycle, it's never about where you're going, just how far. El Cajon Harley-Davidson has custom-designed riding gear built for your body, the bike, and every shift of summer. Around the corner or all the way to the 75th Sturgis Motorcycle Rally. Stop into El Cajon Harley-Davidson and check out the great deals on used bikes and financing offers. Visit ElCajonHarley.com for more details.
Gathering of angels appeared above my head. They sang to me this song.
You know, Epic Phil Kottner, our producer, his band, he's a hair band guy, so in his life before we knew him.
Well, he's getting up there. I'm surprised he didn't have hair.
He was a drummer. Phil's got a good-looking man.
Phil.
He's got a lot of hair. But he just texted me and said, hey, remember my band Feedback, that was Phil's band. They played that. They played all those hot tunes that sometimes we bandy about lightly.
You have to add him, though. Just coming through with every
Adam Clark. Anything, the guy nails it.
Behind the scenes here at the radio station, he's just anything that has the word sailing.
He's on top of it.
Sailing, whatever it takes. It's got it. That's pretty cool.
Well, as if Broc Glover didn't have enough hardware on the mantle at home.
We have to like take a tire iron and get this stuff out of him. It's like, oh, by the way, in casual conversation about something completely unrelated like yard sprinklers, he mentions, you know, Brock, tell us about that. Unadilla coming up, storied place, a storied venue, and what's going to happen at Unadilla this year?
Well, quite the honor, actually. It's if you look at some of the venues around the United States, some of the more famous ones, obviously Unadilla is right at one of the top of the top, the pinnacle of the Mount Rushmore of motocross tracks in the United States.
I would say so.
And I got a nice call last week from the Robinson family asking to make sure that I was going to be at Unadilla, which I said I promised them I would. I just was there here a little while ago for the MX Rewind, and just such a fun venue anyhow. But I'm going to be honored with their walk of fame. And if you've been, some people have been to Glen Helen, they have a walk of fame there. Unadilla also has one for the East Coast. And so they have a lot of inductees, guys like Roger DeCoster. And it was kind of neat one year I was there and Jimmy Weinert was inducted. And
yeah.
Jimmy's an upstate New York guy and one of the pioneers of our sport. So I get to get my ugly mugshot or something alongside
some of the founders
of our sport. And
we're proud of you, Broxton.
Very honored by the Robinson family and Unadilla.
Don't act like you're not impressed.
Yeah, so
that's cool. A good deal. Yeah. You know, speaking of Jimmy Weinert, I had lunch with Dave Arnold, former Honda team manager from years ago, and a wrench back in the days starting in 1975. And he brought up Jimmy Weinert. And Dave looks at it, he's a pretty serious guy. He goes, you know, I'm serious. We are always terrified if when you're pulling out of the hotel parking lot to go to the track or drive somewhere, we'd always look around. If Weinert was anywhere in the neighborhood, he says, you'd literally pull out in your rental car. And if you weren't watching, Weinert would literally T-bone your car. He says you could hear the secondaries kick in across the parking lot. And the big old LTD in the side of your rental car. So they'd even be driving around down the highway sometimes, like headed to Unadilla. All of a sudden, they see a guy just coming a million miles an hour, and you're trying to outrun him and Weinert would just kind of plow into you. Just good-natured fun.
Honestly, it was unbelievable. I mean, now they have so many laws. You have to be over 25.
Those days are over.
It's the motocross guys, I think, you know, I'm sure some NASCAR people, too, ruined the rental car industry.
Fleets.
Absolutely. I mean, I remember waking up back, you know, a lot of the hotels, particularly the old Holiday Inn styles and Ramadas and things.
Sure.
Your room, you know, you got out of your car, you walked across the sidewalk, and you opened the door right there, and your room was exposed to the outside. And you'd wake up in the middle of the night, and you'd hear some, like, okay, somebody's headlights are literally shining in my hotel room. This car has been running for 30, 40, an hour. There's a car running outside my door. And you'd go outside, and it's like a rental car. And particularly the Camaros were the car.
That's what you wanted.
And guys, you know, not to mention, you know, the LOP team and
let's not mention that team
and,
name.
And, you know, guys.
Marty Motes.
Marty Motes and Lorenz Offner. And I remember literally their cars, they would be out driving their cars aggressively, jumping them, doing things, and the frames would bend. And then when they'd bend, the mechanism basically...
Good thing they sprung for the $5 insurance.
Right. Your linkage that puts the car in gear, because they had a center console shifter and automatic transmission.
Right.
But when you bend the frame, it binds the mechanism and the linkage that shifts the car. So they wouldn't be able to put the car in park. But when they'd come in at 3, 4 in the morning... They would.
It's still in gear.
It's still in gear. You can't get the thing into park. They would just put the emergency brake on, leave it idling in drive. Now, what if it ever, for some reason, released, right? It'd end up in the guy's
room. Imagine that.
Imagine it'd be in your hotel room. But they would just leave the car running all night long. I don't even know how would they ever even get it from the position they were in the parking stall.
Yeah,
how would they
would
ever
you?
Get it reversed? I mean, if you can't shift it into park, you can't get it into reverse. I have no idea. And there were so many times, like coming late to a race, we would literally – I remember coming from Mount Morris, even me driving. I remember Marty Smith getting dressed while he's still getting dressed from his motocross gear to his street clothes while I'm driving to the Pittsburgh airport trying to catch the last flight out of the Pennsylvania area on a Sunday night to get to San Diego.
So no shower, no spa.
No. We just wet towel and whatever. That was good enough. Sponge bath. And then just driving as fast as you could. And sometimes if you were really pushing it, you would literally
leave your rental car
at the curbside parking, run in, toss the keys to the counter, say the car is right out front, thanks, and just keep going.
Yes, kids, there was no TSA back then.
Well, it was a metal detector-esque thing that you almost ran through it.
It was just plywood.
Yeah, and we would just
not plugged in.
It had a flashlight like taped to the top of the plywood.
Absolutely. And I remember seeing another Camaro that had actually cleared the over-under jump at the Supercross track, the night track at Rio Bravo Raceway, with one particular Suzuki team manager in it and one famous Suzuki motocross rider at the time who won.
Will not be named.
Yes, and when they were done, and then one exhaust pipe manufacturer guy from Harbor City, he was driving in the car too, and then when they got done with it, you could literally put your entire...
I saw that guy Friday, but I won't name him.
You couldn't put your hand above, because the door didn't have the glass frame all around it. It was just, you know, the top of the glass, and
right.
Then when it rolled down the window, so imagine the driver's side window just didn't, when you open the door, it didn't have a full frame around it.
But when the windows are fully up.
With the windows fully up, you could reach inside the car above the glass window because the car was so tweaked and bent. And for some reason, those Camaros just didn't like to be jumped. And I just...
You'd think they'd engineer a car.
You'd think so.
With that kind of power.
Exactly.
You could jump it.
It was crazy. I just don't even, the reverse. Pierre Karsmachers, I remember him teaching me how to do a reverse spin where you're going down the road at about 50 miles an hour. If you lift off the gas and you gently put it in reverse.
We're going to need a Bike Week disclaimer now.
We could do two episodes about
as long as you lift it off the throttle and you put it in reverse and then you hesitate it for a second and then just put your foot right to the floor, it would actually go into reverse and start spinning the one wheel backwards, and then you whip the wheel and the car would spin around, reverse wheel spin, and it would spin around like three times quicker. And it was no more e-braking and any of that stuff. And so we always laughed at the Hollywood scenes. You know, you'd ever see him do an e-brake, you'd see the rear wheel stop, and then the car would slide.
It's fully locked up.
Yeah, reverse, when you throw it in reverse and do the reverse spins like that, the wheel never comes to a stop, so it looks more action-oriented. And so we learned first in the dirt around the – I remember exactly where I drive by this lake, and now it's completely developed with a shopping center and everything, but it was right across the street from the Ramada Inn in Orlando in Altamont Springs, and I remember Pierre teaching me how to do a reverse spin right there, and
it's like a
16 years old.
It's like a rite of passage. You need to he's handing down, he's a little senior to you, he's handing down these, look, I'm going to show you something, kid, you're not going to get on at home.
Our Hall of Famer Pierre Karsmacher from Holland, he's passing it down to the next generation or two. He's got the young kid, the young Yamaha teammate.
See, and this is pre-social media, Bobby. Actually, it's pre-computer.
Pre-internet.
It's back when, because Dave mentioned this also. He said, you know, here he was more of like, he was a business liaison because he worked for a company. And
I wonder when you get to teach your daughter, JC, that move as she's learning to drive.
Yeah.
She goes, Dad, I heard you on the radio. I heard that you were taught that move. You get to pass it down, right?
Oh, it's entered my mind a few times. But like I said, you got to be 25 to even drive or rent a car basically now. So it probably put me in a tough liability situation after. But it'd be fun to do.
Well, joining us on the hotline, Bike Week Radio Show's favorite guest, Mr. Lyle Lovett. Good morning, Lyle.
Morning, Brock. How you doing?
That would be Bobby over there who just purchased a 13-foot sailboat.
He's going to watch your concert from a sailboat.
Our entire, he's going to be outside of Humphreys.
One of those freeloaders,
in his little 13-foot dinghy that he's calling us a boat.
Hey, Bobby. Well, thanks for having me on, guys.
So what's going on? You had a concert last night just north of the Bay Area, didn't you? And you guys did the tour bus drive down?
Yeah, we were up in Napa County, up in Oakville, and had a great time. We drove down, I just woke up. Sorry, I'm late.
No problem. We understand. It's a tough. I mean, for people who think, I mean, glamour.
It's hard work that you do.
These guys load up after the event and after Lyle, you know, meets and greets. I don't want to say far too many people, but plenty of people, and he does such a great job afterwards. I mean, these guys probably crawl into their bunks around 2 a.m. or something and wake up in the next town, and half the time you guys don't even know where you are. But tonight you're in Riverside, right?
We are in Riverside at the Fox Theater, and I'm excited. You know, some of our moto friends are going to be coming tonight, so I'm excited about that.
Yeah, we were laughing about that earlier. You're about a few miles away from Milestone Raceway and Glen Helen Raceway. I bet you have a few friend requests being in the Inland Empire and the moto capital of the world, huh?
Well, you know, it is really a great feeling to be able to travel around. I mean, traveling around, going to where my friends live, they can't get away from me. I mean, I track them down every year. I track them down every year, and I get to see them, and it really makes it fun. You know, it reminds me a lot of going to the races. You know, when I was growing up, when you go to the races and you see the same folks week in and week out, and you really get to be friends with them. And being on tour, you know, I show up where people live, and I call them up and I invite them to the show, and so it's a great way. Most of the time, most people don't get to see their friends that live in other places quite as often as I do, and I really enjoy that.
You know what? Honestly, you're striking a chord with me. No pun intended there, Mr. Mm-hmm. Musician. But
a little musical.
Because it is true with me, too. It's like you travel around the entire world, and you have friends and, you know, acquaintances. You know, I mean, sometimes they're not close, but you're certainly, you know, want to call them friends in all these areas, and it's really, really nice, and you don't get to see them. If you didn't do what you did, you'd never see them probably, maybe occasional phone call. But the fact that you do what you do on a yearly basis, you might see them once a year, but you still feel like you're good friends with them, and it's very enjoyable. So,
well, it is true. Yeah, you get to stay in touch in a closer way, and that's really nice. Yeah.
So what did we see a couple weeks ago? Did you fly to Boise to ride your you actually have a WR125 Husqvarna, right? And then
– thank you for noticing.
Yeah, but you have it CR. You have the tank like off a CR. Tell us, what is this hodgepodge?
Yeah, what went on there at the Weehee Motorcycle Club in Boise, Idaho?
You know, last year I got to go up. Our buddy Scott Wallenberg invited me up for the 2014 race. They have a vintage race. And I met the guys from Boise Vintage Cycle, Terry Williams and those guys. And they really do an amazing job. And if you've never been to that place, they have a big mail order, online shop where they have lots of old parts, and it's an incredible place to see all the stuff they have. But I asked them to, several of the guys there ride vintage Husqvarnas. And so I asked them if they could find me. I rode a 125 back in my racing days. I would sort of alternate between having a Penton or a Husky. And my very last race bike was a 1973 Husky 125. And I asked them if they thought they could maybe find one about that vintage and fix it up for me. And sure enough, they did. And they had it ready for me this spring for the race that I didn't get to go this year. So finally went up a couple of weeks ago to ride the bike and went up with some of my buddies from the old H&H Music Company racing team, which were the fast guys in Houston, in 1970, 71, 72, up through 74 when all of them decided to go to college and kind of stopped racing. But went up there with Kevin Brown, whose family owned Cloverfield Racetrack in Pearland, Texas, and Steve Hackney, whose family owned H&H Music. And Steve was the fast guy on a Penton in Texas when Steve Wise was still riding minis back in those days.
Yeah, there was a couple other guys that rode for that. Was it Stackable or who else?
Blackwell used to sport.
Or Blackwell used to run that jersey once in a while. Yeah. Mark Blackwell would, huh?
Blackwell did. You know, the Husky team. I worked at a shop called Cycle Shack, which was the Husqvarna Penton dealership, and owned by Richard Sanders. And the Husky team would come down and base out of our shop for the regional races in the winter. When they came down and run Rio Bravo and do nationals in the South. They would kind of base out of Cycle Shack, and Mr. Hackney got to know Blackwell and thought so much of Mark and his riding and just the way Mark is as a person. Invited Mark to be a part of the H&H team, and of course Mark was on the Husky team, but Mark would run the H&H logo that all the team ran on the back of their jerseys. Mark would run it on the front of his jersey and then run his Husqvarna logo on the back, and it was a big deal to us in Houston that Mark would represent Houston that way for us.
Oh, that's very, very cool. So if you don't recognize the voice, talking to Lyle Lovett, multi-Grammy Award winner. And
who will be playing here? When are you playing for us here in San Diego, Lyle?
You know, we'll be at Humphreys by the Sea tomorrow night, Monday night. Mm-hmm. And we get to play Humphreys almost every year. And it's just such a fun place. You know, it's a very casual outdoor atmosphere. And it's right there on the water, and people come up in their boats.
Yeah, Bobby.
Yeah, come on, float on up, Bobby.
That'd be funny.
Two days ago, Bobby was whistling If I Had a Boat. Now he has one.
Yeah, exactly.
Inspired.
Inspired. He's got his dinghy boat.
Be careful what you whistle, Bobby.
Exactly.
I need someone to teach me how to sail it, Lyle. So,
so tonight you're at the Fox Theater in Mission. I think it's in Mission Avenue, right in Old Town Riverside area up there in California. And then tomorrow night, Humphreys by the Bay down in San Diego. Tickets still available both places, and hopefully, are you?
You know, it's getting close. So thankful. You know, the folks down here support us really well, and we always have a good crowd. It's really nice. I never have played the Fox in Riverside, and it's a not a real big theater, but it's one of those cool old restored theaters. And the only time I've ever been to Riverside really before was to go to an open house and a ride at Malcolm Smith Motorsports. So I'm excited.
Speaking of Malcolm Smith, you reminded me. Brock and I just had dinner a few months back with Kenny Jones. And we ate in a bar, correct me if I'm wrong, Brock, it was the original dealership. It was a K&N dealership that Malcolm worked in, and the bar and restaurant.
It was the original building that the K&N motorcycle that was,
became K&N Filters.
K&N Filters and the whole deal. So, but fantastic, Lyle, and Lyle Lovett in concert tonight and tomorrow night in all of Southern California. And listeners out there, motorcycle, he's one of us. Go out and support him, and we'll for sure the Bike Week Radio crew will see you at Humphreys and get some good music and with the large band.
Thanks for having me on, Broc.
All right, Lyle, you be good.
Congratulations on your boat, man.
You'll see it.
Thanks, Lyle.
Thanks, Lyle. See ya.
One of the best in the business right there.
One last little shout out to a great Bike Week Radio Show loyal listener from day one, my brother-in-law, Warren Dunham. Today's his birthday. I think he's, 29, 30, something like that.
Yeah. Happy birthday, Warren.
Well, that'll do it for Bike Week Radio Show. We'll be back next Sunday right here on San Diego Sports Leader, the Mighty 1090.
You've been listening to Bike Week Radio Show.
Powered by GEICO. 15 minutes can save you 15% or more on motor.